Hello and welcome to this new session at the Huarus Conference. I'm Hindulchan Gupta, I'm Vice President Invest India. And of course, with me, there were supposed to be three speakers, but due to various confusions, I believe at the moment I only have one speaker, and that is Shivakumar Gunturu, CEO of Maple Software Private Limited. Also supposed to have Shamit Khemka, Founder and Managing Director of Synapse India, and Paul Sanar, Chairman CloudGaze from the United States. If they can join later, we will of course accommodate them. But at the moment, Mr. Gunturu and I will have a conversation on the topic of the day, the growing attraction of the Indian offshoring industry. I want to begin by setting the stage for this conversation. And that is to explain that Indian offshoring has long been, in a sense, the backbone of India's technological prowess. All the things that we talk about today, we have to remember some of the most exciting things started with our offshoring businesses. There were many reasons why these businesses became successful. Price was only one part of it, but agile, nimble, technological prowess was an equally another very important part of why these businesses succeeded. So price was not the only reason. And as India digitizes further and further, there's a deep digitization within India. What happens really is that India becomes an even more important destination for offshoring, as in a sense, the back office of the world. We're going to discuss all of these things and more, and constant Indian efforts to reform to attract more and more businesses and in the sector with Mr. Gunturu. I'm going to now, since there are only two of us, I'm going to toss it to him for his early remarks on how he sees the sector today and its future. And perhaps he would also like to comment very briefly, one or two points, on how it has progressed over the years.
Certainly. Good afternoon and greetings to everyone. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, I think so.
Perfect. Greetings to everyone. Let me just introduce myself. My name is Shivakumar Gunturu. That's my last name. I'm the CEO of a company called Maple Software. We are based out of India with operations in the United States and Canada, and also have clients across the world. So, Hindul, thanks for having me. And I also want to thank Dr. Frank for inviting me for this session. And all the participants from world over, welcome to this event. It's a very important and an interesting subject, outsourcing. Well, outsourcing is very broad in the sense outsourcing can be in terms of manufacturing, it can be in services, but I'm going to focus more on IT services. That's the subject, like, you know, which I'm very fond of, and that's the business I'm into. So let me just focus more on that. That in itself is a big subject. And I may not be able to cover everything. Let me see what best I can do with the limited time I have. As much as I want to focus only on the present and the future of this IT outsourcing in India and the advantages and on how it is growing, I would like to quickly do a fast forward of the past, which is something that we cannot avoid at this moment. So let me just tell you, in the year 1995, when I returned from the United States after finishing my master's and working for a little while, that's when, like, you know, I wanted to get into IT. I figured out that we actually, by then we already had a few companies. They were, like, you know, already doing the work for countries like United States and UK. And back then, I still recall they were sending the work back and forth with compact disks and floppy disks. Well, gone are the days, and, like, you know, over the time, the IT has evolved and services have evolved. Indian companies invested in R&D and they've grown from being just services companies into product delivery. And after seeing the advantages of the Indian IT outsourcing, especially the companies have come with the primary motive of getting good talent. As Hindul said, mentioned earlier, it's not just the cost. It is the talent pool that's available here, and that's the first reason why they moved here. And of course, the cost and the time advantages that the Indian offshoring has given, those advantages were the ones which were taken into consideration subsequently. Over the time, with the success of these companies having delivered, the companies in United States have and UK have set up their own subsidiaries here. Well, Indian companies who have started, who had a head start, did not lose the opportunity. They in turn went to the United States and UK and set up their shops, and they have grown from being just service providers in India to multinational companies. So that is a story, and today proudly I can say India has grown from just providing services and manpower into providing into solution providers and system integration. Well, with the fast forward that I have done, let me just come to the present. Now, currently, we should talk about we are talking about close to 4 million people who are working in the IT industry, and it is growing. It is growing, and the current revenues are close to about $167 billion, and it's likely to grow to $350 billion by 2025. Isn't that a big jump? And this is not something that I'm saying. It's already the world over, all the reports are already projecting these numbers. Having said that, even the number of people that are required for these services are going to double to close to about 8 million people. Now, the one more good news here is India is the third startup, it is ranked third in the startup ecosystem. It's close to about 5,000 startups, be it the NASSCOM startups or CIA startups, and the startups that have actually been there with a lot of other incubators of various states. Let's say also take T-Hub, which is in Hyderabad, which is one of the largest incubation centers. So that has grown very big. And the other numbers I want to really talk about now is 80% of Indian outsourcing is primarily happening with United States and UK, and the rest 20% is from the rest of the world. Well, the good news once again for the Indian companies, that 20% is really going to go to the is going to grow from countries like Japan, MENA region, that's Middle East and North Africa, and not to forget, there is a surprising interest from Latin America. Because I keep attending a lot of seminars and business promotions, especially ESC, NASSCOM, CIA are getting delegations from all over the world, and there's an interest from Latin America, Japan, and Europe, and some of the European countries. So I want to make a quick mention about the language barrier here, which doesn't seem to be really affecting the Indian IT. So I want to take a quick mention of Japanese and the renewed interest. The business between Japan and the European countries, we're talking about close to $350 billion by 2025. Now, is India going to lose that? No. So the Japanese companies and also the JETRO, you must be knowing the organization called JETRO, and also the Japanese embassy have set up Japanese language skill schools. Japan, France is not left behind. One example I can take is Mahindra Ecole. I don't know how many of you are aware, is tied up with a French university. And my son is, by the way, studying there, so that's why I've come to know about it. And they started teaching French right from day one till they graduate. So we are actually talking about French-speaking students from India from a reputed institute. So that means you're talking about 10,000-20,000 students who are graduating in the next 2 to 3 years. And they are the ones who get an opportunity. So that interest is actually growing. And in other words, what I'm trying to tell you is the traditionally English-speaking countries are not the only ones which are going to be outsourcing to India. Also Japan, France, and also other countries who are in. So Latin America is not falling behind. In fact, there is a lot of interest, especially in the areas of machine learning from Latin America. And that is one opportunity. Let me quickly go to the statistics, Hindul, if you permit me. So I want to just take give you some inputs on the statistics. So India is actually, Indian IT industry is contributing close to 10% of the GDP, of the Indian GDP, in terms of the IT revenues. And the second thing is Indian market in itself is growing. Currently, it's at $90 billion. And likely to grow to $100 billion in the next 5 years. that's a huge jump, keeping India's slow pace, and also the value is something that that needs to be looked at. And the second thing is not only good news for the Indian companies, it's also good news for the companies in US and UK, because there are a lot of products that can be sold to these clients. Not to forget, there is with the cloud services, and especially with cyber crimes in upswing. We had Pegasus, which is actually has already hit the market, and with the cyber threats looming large, a lot of companies, including us and my clients, are moving to cloud. So suddenly, in the last 2 years, we have noticed that there is renewed interest in cloud, and that industry is going to grow to $200 billion by 2025. And all this while, any service that you want to take on cloud was primarily going to the United States because of the data security and the laws, which are very stringent, and also the availability of a lot of these cloud services and data centers, which are coming at a very reasonable cost. So the good news here is Indian cloud service providers, and recently the data centers were being set up by Adani, Reliance, and there are a lot of small and medium companies which have come up. One of them is Pi Data Center, which is right there in my state, and they're doing extremely well. And that market alone is going to be about $5 billion by 2025. That's a good news to all of us, because there is a renewed, not only the interest, and I would say the trust on the Indian laws and also the data centers. So that's the point I'm trying to drive here. Well, the advantages of India is known to everyone, and that's the reason everyone is coming to India for outsourcing. There are a couple of things which I really want to highlight here, Hindal, and the rest of the participants. Especially the countries who are outsourcing and the companies who are outsourcing. The good news is, of course, the large companies have set up their own delivery centers across the world. Even the small and medium companies are setting up delivery centers across the world. And not only the Indian government is encouraging this, even the local governments are encouraging that. So, there's a renewed interest in that area. And the second thing is, Indian government is actually giving a very good support in terms of increasing the infrastructure. Earlier, they used to actually have infrastructure facilities and growing the infrastructure only in tier one cities like Delhi, Pune, Mumbai, Hyderabad, Bangalore, Chennai. But the recent union budget in financial year 2021 has allocated $7.5 billion. They are planning to invest into infrastructure in tier 2 and 3 cities. Thanks to pandemic, in a way, I would say, though it is not a good news to a lot of us. Thanks to pandemic, tier 2 and 3 cities are actually gaining a lot of importance. Infrastructure is building there. And more importantly, skill development is happening in these tier 2 and 3 cities, which is very, very important. And that is going to actually add a lot of value, not only to the Indian IT companies, also to the companies worldwide. Because all this while, because of this cost arbitrage, and also the infrastructure requirements, they were not able to really go to the tier 2, 3 cities. And we're still getting stuck at tier 1 cities and paying more. Now, with with the pandemic, a lot of people have moved into their towns. And that proved that, yes, it is possible to actually do business in tier 2, 3 cities as well. So that's going to bring down.
I'm going to interrupt you here, Shukumar. And ask you mentioned when you were giving your opening remarks about the government's consistent efforts to re-energize the sector, including, last year also there were a bunch of reforms. Could you take us through on how some of these reforms have impacted and boosted India's chance, including in boosting the SaaS industry, the SaaS industry, software services industry, in which India's poised to be, or is already perhaps, the back office of the world?
Very good question, Hindal. You are absolutely right in terms of the government support, but SaaS is a different ballgame altogether. SaaS is software as a service, it means a product. But India has actually been a primary provider of only services so far. India hasn't actually matured, or I would not say like, you know, they never actually had like, you know, an opportunity or didn't really look at the developing SaaS products. But companies like Infosys have actually done that, but only the large companies are doing it so far. So it is not much talked about. The reason being, there's like, you know, services are like, you know, the services itself is actually keeping them like, you know, up and running. So they're not really looking at that. So as far as the government's support in terms of like, you know, the infrastructure support and other things are concerned, let me tell you, all the government related work, all the SaaS models, you know, currently it is not happening in the private sector, but government related, be it defense or other governments, it's all going SaaS based. So a lot of companies like Microsoft are actually offering those services. And yes, government is actually giving them incentive for doing that. Yes.
I also wanted to talk about a little bit about this transition. You know, we hear constantly that India is becoming the back office of the world, but the back office of the world is not just in the old, you know, data processing and, you know, transcription and things like that, right? It is also, the reason I brought in SaaS was, it is also about adding value-added products and services, which can be, in a sense, outsourced to India, right? You know, we know, for instance, companies like Zoho Corp and so on and so forth, they are actually building products that can do the work that a far more expensive, you know, company maybe in other parts of the world can do at a fraction of the cost, but at similar quality. So India is slowly building that prowess, right, to provide a 360-degree ecosystem, not just services, but also products. And I wonder how you look at all of this, the coming of AI, of course, the coming of, you know, blockchain, all of these processes coming together. How do you see the future?
Good question, Hindol. Let me tell you, Zoho, you know, which is a CRM company, as you know, based out of Chennai, and like, you know, they have their delivery center from there, but they also have gone to their, like, you know, the village level. If you are aware, the CEO actually comes from, you know, one of those places, and he set up like, you know, one of his delivery centers in one village, that's his own village. Now, you also have to see where they're coming from. It is a migration from the Western world to here, and that company has not grown from here. It has come from there, from the US to here. So the point of like, you know, whether SaaS models are being developed here and then going westwards, the answer is no, not yet. So somewhere we had to build that capability. So why is that we are not able to build the capability? We always have to look at the consumer. The consumer is like, you know, where the value comes, where the consumer is all in the Western world as of now. And that's the reason, like, you know, even for services, we are looking at that part of the world. So the moment you are actually able to activate that market, and like, you know, you have to start there because you have to be there and you have to deliver it to the consumers there, is when the activity starts there. You can only do a backward integration by coming, like, you know, to India. Somehow, like, as much as I want it to be like, you know, a product like, you know, country, that is not going to happen unless and until India in itself becomes a big consumer. So far, that is not happening. And that pace, the pace we are going at is slow, number one. Number two, government's intervention is absolutely required, where they are the largest consumer, not only in India, rest of the world, like, you know, they are the largest consumer. So that's where, like, you know, the government will have to come and say, look, we are going to utilize your products. So I come from Andhra Pradesh. So my government at one time, they started an initiative. They said, we want to encourage the local entrepreneurs, try to use all the products that they are actually developing within AP to see if we can utilize them in the government and also for the people, for the e-governance. So they had several meetings, and to figure out out of like, you know, the several meetings, I was a part of that, they could identify 10 of them and they were able to implement. So such kind of initiatives should come from not only the local government, also from the union government, and the consumption is very important and there should be a dedication for that.
Let's see if we have any questions from the audience. Nothing at the moment. I can't see any questions. Let me then ask you, you were talking about the future, and I wanted to ask you whether you saw this transition that you're saying is not yet happening soon in the future as deep digitization continues in India.
So you mean to say the transition pre-pandemic
From only services to products that are first absorbed locally, used locally, grow locally, and then, of course, go across the world?
Yes. So the question is, the transition is happening or not? Is that what it is?
Yes, and by when do you see it happen?
Okay, great. So as I said, once again, it goes back to my previous answer. So that is where the consumption comes into picture. One great news is with data centers like being set up here, and the government's intervention and their renewed interest in Indian products. The Make in India is not only for manufacturing. Make in India is also for services and the products that are going to be from India. So within the next 5 years, the numbers that I talked about from 90 billion to 100 billion, 100 billion of consumption within India, that 10 billion is going to be the one which is going to be locally consumed. Though that is not significant compared to the rest of the world, but that's a step forward, and I see that is going to happen pretty soon. So within the next 5 years, I see there's going to be a big change.
Fascinating. What impact will new technologies like AI or, blockchain have in this whole process?
Well, see, artificial intelligence and machine learning. Traditionally, India has been consuming the products from outside. Yeah, we were always importing. And coming to the AI and machine learning, there is a very big innovation that is happening elsewhere. Now, I work within India with the defense and also some local governments. So I can actually talk about what is their appetite for this AI and machine learning. In the last 2 years, after the Make in India program has actually made very popular, by the previous government and also the current government, I have noticed that these consumers have actually wanted to try it out. So they wanted to see how they can actually have machine learning within their organization and also include AI, but not much progress as of now. Now, what they're trying to see is they want to see the buzzwords, the so-called buzzwords that are there now, how it is going to pan out in the rest of the world. Now, in the industry that I'm into healthcare, where machine learning is very, very important, artificial intelligence is very important. I can see even in the US, the pace is still slow. I'm expecting by 2030 is when it is actually going to be a very big industry. For example, in machine learning, there is something called what do you call the data, the learning for the machine learning, the indentation. Yeah. So those kind of things are still happening. The machine will have to learn, and then it'll have to repeat, and still it is at 80%. So it is going to take time, and this industry is going to be big. So India has traditionally been a country which is going to see how it is going to come up in the rest of the world and then replicate it here. So having said that, so whether this is going to happen in the next 5 years, the answer from my side is no. But there's going to be an interest, but it's not going to be how it is in the rest of the world.
Okay. In conclusion, I want to ask you, offshoring has always been one of those exciting domains which has impacted even popular culture. You think about the book that Chetan Bhagat wrote and movies that have been made about it and so on and so forth, right? Is Indian offshoring today transitioning to a new dimension, or is it actually, pivoting to cater to more of a domestic audience and at a time of, supply chain resilience, concerns about supply chain resilience? Where do you see that, play out in the world of offshoring?
Let me not talk about the domestic market because which is insignificant today. So let me focus more on the outsourcing part. As I mentioned before, we are talking about doubling the revenues in the next 5 years. So coming to what are all the different factors that are going to actually help us double these numbers? Let us look at the opportunities and the verticals that are going to come up in increasing this offshoring. So all this while, everyone said, look, the moment automation comes into picture, a lot of jobs will be gone. Yeah. So in the last 2, 3 years, we heard about this kind of misnomers, I would say. Well, the last 1 year, 130,000 hirings have happened. So that is like, you know, out of the 40 million that I'm talking about, 40 lakhs, like you're talking about 3 to 4% hiring happened during the pandemic when people thought nothing is going to move. And in the next 1 year, we are expecting like, you know, almost equal amount of like, you know, hiring that's going to happen. To be honest with you, being a small to medium sector company, we myself, like, you know, we ourselves have grown from being like, you know, just a 250 to 300 people company to 500 in the last 1.5 years. So what I'm trying to tell you is the pandemic did not really affect like, you know, our growth. And what I found is the earlier, whatever people used to think about the agility, speed, and the speed of delivery, and also the talent, and also the cost arbitrage, which subsequently, like, you know, died, saying that, okay, cost is not the main factor, but looks like there's a renewed opinion about that. And a lot of people have looked at the cost also during the pandemic. And also, more importantly, the delivery capabilities. Not the cost alone, it's also the delivery capabilities that have encouraged outsourcing. And what I'm seeing is during and like, you know, the post-pandemic, there's going to be a renewed interest. And we don't know whether this is going to stay for like, you know, 1 year or 2 years. Nobody is able to predict. Last year, they said within 6 months, it's going to be over. Well, we are 1.5 years into it. Nothing happened. And like, you know, we're still talking about a third wave. And after third wave, I don't know whether they're going to talk about fourth wave, you know. But nevertheless, the pandemic is here to stay, and like, you know, this outsourcing is like, you know, is going to grow with the. Now, one thing I want to really highlight here is the earlier the misconception or the myth was people should be co-located either in the office or in the client location,
yeah,
for doing the work. Yeah. So that increased a lot of costs because people had to travel. You had to have like, you know, a big establishment. But pandemic really taught us something in the last 1 year that is not like, you know, is not actually required. And more importantly, pandemic also taught us that, look, you don't have to be really in the office, and you can still cut the cost and like, you know, work from home and like, you know, still deliver. So having said that, the companies have like, you know, changed their strategy, and like, you know, now they are hiring people globally, and they even don't mind hiring people from the tier 2 and 3 cities. So that's already become like, you know, the norm in like, you know, in India. And before the pandemic, like, you know, the second wave and the third wave went, which is likely to be by the end of this year, and we are likely to touch about close by another 25%. So I'm talking about from being a $200 billion to $250 billion revenue in the next 6 months to 1 year.
Fascinating. That's a very optimistic note to in which to conclude this session. Thank you very much, Shiv Kumar Gunturu, for joining us. Shiv Kumar Gunturu, CEO of Maple Software Private Limited, joining us today on the session on the growing attraction of Indian offshoring, explaining why the time for Indian offshoring, which never really happened, but is in a sense back once again. Thank you very much for your time. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much, everybody who joined us. Thanks.
Thanks for having me, Hindal. Have a good day.
Thank you.